in a moment. And a little bit later on in the webinar, we're going to be being joined by Graeme, Ellis, first team scout at St Mirren. But Tony, really, before we get going, football in the last month, anything that you want to have a comment on, anything that you've thought has been of interest the last month?
Generally, Ryan, or in terms
generally.
Just generally, well, obviously, look, there's no getting away from the big news yesterday that Chelsea is up for sale. Everyone in the football community, you know, I was at a game, I was at Middlesbrough Spurs on Tuesday night. Everyone in the football community has got right behind Ukraine and what's happening there. So there's no getting away from that. And while, you know, we need to focus attention on what's happening, obviously, major news for Premier League club to be up for sale, or even could those assets be frozen of Chelsea and, you know, he isn't able to sell it. So that's, a non-footballing interesting point that's happened in the past week. Going beyond that, though, I think, you know, we're getting back to some sort of normality. All of the COVID cancellations obviously have had their effect on the league, but at least now we seem to be through the woods. Games have been, you know, fitted in the midweek and what have you, and it seems to me that we're more or less back on track of where we should be. There will be a few extra games that people have back end of the season, but, you know, we're more or less on track to complete a normal season.
Yeah, and Tony, just before we get before getting into today's main webinar, I just wanted to just anchor the point. And we spoke about it last night on a course that we were doing. Where do you think this conflict in Ukraine puts FIFA in terms of rolling out the proposed changes to agents this year? From my perspective, I just don't see how they can happen if there's an active conflict going on that's encompassing two or three countries within Europe. I don't see how it can happen.
Well, look, FIFA and Infantino's cozied up to Russia, hasn't he? You know, and there's no getting away from that. They were quite happy, the Gazprom sponsorship, the sports washing that's been going on, you know, and Infantino's been seen in many, many settings with the Russian leader. And that's not going to go well for FIFA, is it? You know, in terms of their overall strategy, that's, you know, it's opened up now. It's completely, you know, this is going to change a lot of things. And football has been really solid in its backing. And, you know, FIFA tried to sort of say, oh, just crack on with the matches and we'll call it the Football Union of Russia.
Yeah, the Red Lion, yeah.
Yeah. Well, the countries, and I think it was the Polish FA was the first person to come out and say, no, we're not playing Russia. This is just unacceptable. And unfortunately, you cannot divide, and FIFA hasn't let politics and sport divided. They've encouraged politics into sport, and now they're having to reap, they're getting, you know, what they deserve from it, because, you know, now it's not just sport, is it? It's sport washing. It's politics has been brought into sport, and this has happened.
And the last one before we get into the main thrust of the webinar. So, you know, governments talk tough then now on the dirty money that exists in this country, and how this country's been used to, as you say, to wash a lot of dirty money. You know, it's not only going to be the Russian-owned clubs that are going to be in trouble. What about Newcastle?
Honestly, Ryan, when I came on this morning, I thought we were going to just have a nice football chat.
And boring.
Absolutely boring. Blown it out of the water. Yeah. I made my feelings clear on Newcastle in the last webinar that we did about the takeover of Newcastle. This situation, it's opened up a whole can of worms now, hasn't it? You know, it absolutely has. But it's because of that relationship with governments, with FIFA, with football, with the Premier League, those relationships and the term sport washing, who our friend Simon, Professor Simon Chadwick, has been talking about for 10 years. You know, he's the busiest man on the planet at the moment because he's he's talking all about things that he'd been talking about 10 years ago and that has come home to roost. So it's opened a massive can of worms, Ryan. And I think, you know, me, I'm not in a real position to have any serious commentary about it.
I know he has been busy, Simon, but has he got three kids to get ready for World Book Day tomorrow? I don't think so. Yeah. Right. One last one then, Tony. You were at the Middlesbrough game on Tuesday. You know, you're from Middlesbrough. Come on. I'll give you your 10 seconds of glory. Did you enjoy the game?
As a fan, I was there. You know, as a fan, I've got a player there. But as a fan, it was an absolutely fantastic evening. I just want to highlight Steve Gibson. You know, it's the only ground that I've been to where the fans actually chant the owner's name. And I think for me, that just says it all. You know, if you don't know who your owner is of the club, if you don't even like your owners, if they don't even engage with you, then it's getting a bit political. It wasn't set out to be like this, Ryan. You set me up for this.
I think it was a great experience.
Middlesbrough deserved to win. And what is better in my football world than a young kid from the academy, grown up in not far from the ground, comes on and scores the winner, smashes home the winner? What more can you ask for in football? That's the dream for me.
I don't think you're quite right there. I think that other clubs do sing the names of the executives at the club. I've had it myself, but it's not in a glowing light though, Tony. It's not in the positive light, Steve.
Oh, sorry. I remember that. Was that chant at Stockport? Was it?
Yeah, Ryan McKnight is a It's a family webinar. Okay, great stuff. Good introduction. So let's introduce Nick Daws, head of recruitment operations at Motherwell. Good morning, Nick. How are you?
Morning, Ryan. Morning, Tony.
How's it going?
Yeah, great. Thank you.
Excellent. Good stuff. Well, really appreciate you joining us this morning. Tony and I spoke for a few months about trying to do something a bit more SBL centric. But before we get into the specifics around Motherwell, just a little bit of background on yourself, Nick, really, and how you've ended up at Motherwell.
Well, start from the probably closest possible time, really. I guess my relationship with Graeme Alexander, the manager, worked together for a couple of years at Scunthorpe with him, as people will probably know. Actually had the caretaker job before he took it off me and got the full-time job, and then took over after him and got the job for a very, very short spell after. So we've had a really close relationship over that time. That's tied together with a long-standing friendship and relationship with Graeme's assistant, Chris Lachetti, who I've known since we were young pros at Bury back in the day, 30 years ago now, which is mad to even say that. So, it's about working with people that you've got a good bond with, you trust. The actual fact, I think, that I've worked with Graeme on the pitch makes this side of it easier. When I'm speaking to the likes of Tony, I can try to translate that go between what happens on the pitch, what Graeme's like, what he expects, and that's makes my job a lot easier. That's really where it in short where it came from.
Brilliant. And now obviously heading up the recruitment ops at Motherwell. I mean, for you, what does that mean? Are you based in Scotland, or are you based in England, or is it a hybrid across the both?
Kind of hybrid. I'm based in England. I think Motherwell were one of the first SPL clubs to do that. Originally with Gary Hours back in around 2014, I think, 2014-15, and then Martin Foyle after him. Obviously, Martin was there for a long time, did a fantastic job. I think it was part of the club's DNA, really, just to think about the pool of players, the coverage that they can provide up there. And at the time, this is probably before Brexit, the only other pool of players available realistically were the odd player from abroad, but primarily, English-based players. So, That's I go up twice a month for probably 3, 4, 5 days. Yep. I was up last Thursday till Monday, so I got all the football in at the weekend. But going back to the other part of your question, it was to really just have a look at it, review what was happening, take everything into consideration that we'll probably come on in terms of modern recruitment and what the future of recruitment looks like, and put some strategy in place.
Fantastic. So just before we get into those sort of wider, bigger conversations, how is the strategy now at Motherwell? You know, for those that follow the SPL and maybe Motherwell, you know, you've recruited from Ireland, you know, you've recruited from other places. Is there a specific template that you're working towards at the moment?
I think the only template is Graeme's game model and the player profiles that fit within it. I think after that, the advantage of us being able to recruit from outside the UK, probably come onto the exemptions panel up in Scotland at some point further down the line, has allowed us to go to Norway to get Sondre Solholm, to go to Denmark to get Finnish international Yohani Ayala. And to go to Belgium in the window just gone to get Joe Efford, who's a US national. So, you know, as well as Ross, Ireland's a big market. It's a big market for everybody. It's not a secret. But for us, still working within our budget, it's allowed us to, you know, get emerging players, unknown talent from a wider field. So I think Brexit was going to be a challenge for Scotland with the impact that it's going to have on England. So it's really fortunate for us to be able to you know, to fish in a larger pool.
And Graeme, I mean, you'll have to educate us here and the people on the call, because a lot of English clubs have not looking at certain markets because they couldn't get the GBE. Is that exemptions panel a little bit more flexible in Scotland? What's the situation?
Yeah, so the situation is exactly that. It's more flexible. It allows you to put a case, a discretionary case forward for a player that perhaps doesn't have the required 15 GBE points. Mm. So without going into the sort of finer details, it still takes into consideration the obvious, which most people know, and that's the country tier, the domestic club tier, the amount of minutes, et cetera, that the player plays, the continental competitions that they play in, all that adds to it. In Joe Efford's case, he'd had a year in the top league in Belgium, which actually gave him a lot more points than it gave the two players that were playing in the top league in Denmark and Norway.
Right. So that 11 to 15 points for the exemption panel, are they still having to hit the 11, or can they go below that?
I don't know. We were probably there or thereabouts with the two boys in the summer. We were close to actually 15 points with Joe, bizarrely, in the end. I think he was 13 or even 14.
Right, great.
That was primarily because of that full season he had. It was averaged out. He spent 18 months in Belgium, 12 months of that with Beveren, was in the top league. So that gave him, you know, more points than he would have been.
And so, Nick, obviously we don't want to go into the details, you know, don't tell us anything that is confidential, but have you had quite a lot of exemption panels? Has there been many that haven't got through? You've fancied a player and he was, the exemption panel sort of gone, well, you haven't quite made the case or whatever it is?
No, but they're the only three that we've put, in fairness. And I think it was, I don't know whether it was more relaxed in the summer. The summer was a little bit of a trial, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah,
it was obviously a case put forward by the clubs in Scotland to keep that permanent. So our only example of it is a player that, you know, was only a couple of points short anyway. Right. So the chances are that wasn't going to be a problem. Whether it'll be, I guess it's just testing the water as we move forward.
Yeah, absolutely. But I suppose that leads on to your recruitment strategy, knowing that the exemption panel, you've had some success with it. It then opens up a bit more of a lot more number of players, I suppose, and helps to sort of formulate, because we're all still finding out about what you can and you can't do with the new GBE regs, and you know, when you go to an exemption panel, it can be hit and miss, but we're all sort of getting settled in, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It is. It's. I think in time. I guess the big question is, it's the same over here. It's like the number of foreign nationals allowed in each club in each country. It's at some point, it won't be good for the game for, the young boys coming through in Scotland if, everybody's going and trying to get players from outside the UK, within the EU, outside of the EU, because some of those are easier. So I'm sure it's a case where it's being monitored on a, on a signing by signing basis, and I'm sure they'll review it at the end of the season and have a look at how that's done.
Yeah, I'm really interested to know what the vibe is in that exemption panel. Was it yourself? Were you having to go in and pitch the player, or did you have legal counsel? How did it work?
No, I wasn't. I didn't take place of those. It was Alan, our CEO, and Graeme. And it's just a case of putting a case forward of why that player will enhance your team. I don't suppose it's any different, really. I suppose just to give you a little bit of a nugget of information, I suppose with Yohani being a Finnish international, there was an element of, what he can bring. He'd also played in five countries. So for instance, if it's some of our younger, less experienced academy centre-backs, for instance, the wealth of knowledge and experience he could bring to them, in part of their development. So that will have been one of the things that we will have discussed.
Yeah, Tony, I don't know what you think, but I'm always thinking you're having what are, I guess, sort of subjective chats, and who are you having the subjective chat to? Who's on the other side of the desk? And you're really at their mercy at the end of the day.
Well, but I'm pleased to hear that,
these
are the experts, the guys who are in recruitment and the manager and the CEO. If they want the player to come in and they think he's valuable and he's a useful asset to the club, and, you're not asking for a whole team, but you're asking for two or three or three or four. Yeah. These guys are the experts. They know what they're doing. You'd hope that the panelists, who's ever on the other side of the table, sort of goes, well, unless it's a complete, these are proper footballers. They're coming into the country. They're going to enhance the game. They're going to be useful for Motherwell. Get on with it, and I'm sort of pleased. I think that gives Scottish football generally, the quality will obviously improve if you're only fishing from a Scottish pond, for example, which I know they're not, but you haven't got access to two or three foreign players. It's going to be good for the game. It's also good for the actual image of the game in Scotland. If you've got international players from other countries, Finland or wherever, there's going to be an interest in where they're playing, obviously, and it spreads the word a bit as well. And I think that's just all for the good, really.
Mm. It's really interesting having you on Nick, in terms of some of the quirks that exist in Scotland around agents as well. There's no requirement for agents to register in Scotland at the moment. Have you found a material difference working in Scotland in terms of either the volume or the demographic or the type of agent that you've been liaising with?
I don't think so, if I'm honest, Ryan. I've nothing noticeable at the moment. A lot of the big players in the market, will have somebody that's based up there or has a connection. So that's been quite common. So whilst I would generally have probably dealt with an agent, that's based in England, I'm passed through to a colleague who's based in Scotland, and I think that's as Tony will probably know, that's really, really common now. I think a couple of the guys, the smaller agents, have been have partnered with another agency, so I've found that. But no, I think probably even less so. I mean, going back to my previous stint at AFC Wimbledon, I probably experienced more, how should I describe it, sort of family, friends, and down in that part of the world, guys that have got academy setups, that bring their players through their academy setup, private academy setups, not club setups.
Yeah.
Who would go on to represent, that player, at least for the first stage of their career, if not beyond.
Interesting. So what do you see as the big issues in the SPL? You know, what are the sort of big, you know, one or two or three big issues that you know, clubs like Motherwell would like to see rectified?
I'm not sure rectified. I think it's difficult. I mean, you're always going to face the usual ones, and that's, you know, the bigger 4/5 clubs in the league, as Graeme will be pay testament to as well, have got much bigger budgets than we have. So I think it would have been a huge challenge for us to have operated like we do without the situation regarding GBE exemptions that we spoke about before. I think COVID, having come out of that COVID period, I think within the COVID period, it proved tough to get perhaps as many boys north of the border from England as prior to that, prior to COVID, because I think a few were stuck up here, stuck up in Scotland with under lockdown and couldn't get back down. So those were some of the challenges. And again, I think that'll be an ongoing one. You know, it's about finance, isn't it, Ryan? It's about whether, you know, within our budget, whether we can afford, you know, the pool of players that most of the teams in the lower part of the SPL are fishing in is probably a proportion of League Two and a small part of League One. The loan market obviously is quite separate. I think a lot of the clubs see the SPL has been a good league for their players to go to because they're going to play at Ibrox and Parkhead and Aberdeen, et cetera, et cetera. So that's better in some ways than playing at, you know, with all due respect to clubs in where I'm from originally, Rochdale or over here where I was previously at Scunthorpe. So, so there are pros and cons, but I think how the competition now and for players in England will make it tougher for us to get players from England.
Yeah.
Because the demand, you know, the demand will be higher because obviously the exemption panel is not in place down there. That's a big issue for us, I think.
Have you got a few loanees at the moment, or do you tend to use that, you know, obviously good players from Cat 1, Cat 2 club academies? Have you used that in January or summer before that?
We used it on two occasions, but both players were from the SPL. So we took Jordan Roberts on loan for the first half of the season from Hearts and then signed him permanently in January. And Liam Shaw from Celtic, who moved up from Sheffield Wednesday last summer. So we've been active. We've been active certainly in the market in England, and it's one of the areas that we focus heavily on. But we've not yet brought somebody up. It's daft, isn't it? Really, well, it's not daft. It is. In some ways, to get an English boy north of the border is the perception that it's the other side of the world.
It's crazy, isn't it? It's crazy.
Yeah. It is. So it's like the recruiting from the English market. You know, for every one that says yes, you know, there's probably nine that say no because they don't want to come to Scotland. It's easier for me now in it to see how incredibly beneficial it is for a player's career. Having been a player myself, you know, playing in a top league, broadcast footage every week, sports scene and live games, you know, across the weekend, the profile is a lot better than it is for League One and League Two. And I think in terms of the development player, that the interesting one is that aside from 3-4 times a season, you get to work with your manager, your coaching staff, you know, 4 days a week rather than the grind of League One and League Two and the Championship where you play, recover for two-thirds, three-quarters of the season. So there's no time to develop apart from the development of, there you go, you're thrown into it. And you sink or swim.
So Nick, you know, most of the Premier League clubs now have a loan manager, several of them in the Championship as well. Are these the guys you were talking to regularly? I, when you are looking for a couple of players, are you engaging with them, or is it still the sporting directors, the chief scouts, or are you going direct to, you know, like our big friend Guy Branston, who's obviously part of the Football Transfer Forum? You know, is it you're ringing Guy up and seeing what he's got, or what's the situation?
Yeah, it's just understanding how each club operates. So in Leicester's case, with Guy, in the case of Brighton with David Weir, that's slightly probably going to change now. I don't know Gordon Greer. I met Gordon Greer in a similar situation, so I don't know if Gordon's taken over from David in that interim with Dan leaving. So those situations, yes, I'd speak when I spoke to Brentford primarily at AFC Wimbledon. I either speak to Alan, the loans manager, or straight to Phil Giles sometimes, yeah, dependent. And that was probably dependent on the type of player that we were looking to recruit from Brentford for AFC Wimbledon. So yeah, it's about understanding, you know, who that person is to get the best decision, and who knows the who you have a relationship, and who knows about what your plan is for the player.
Yeah, and the other thing I was going to ask about, which is SPL, started a little bit in the Premier League. There is a winter break though, isn't there now? Is there? Mm. And how long was that winter break?
Round about 3 weeks. It wasn't totally fixed for each club, so it was due to start, I think, the 2nd of January, right, when we were supposed to play St Mirren. So we'd have finished after that, and that would have gone until around about the 22nd, 23rd of January. It was then brought forward because of COVID. First Minister obviously shut or reduced the fans to 500 for the remaining three games. And then the SPL club said, look, you know, can we just not close it now? So we had to play Boxing Day, which we did, but then the next two games were postponed as the winter break was brought forward.
So would you know, is that a case of the lads get a couple of weeks off or a week off or something? Do you get any time off, or is it just literally you're just not playing matches but you're training a lot? What is it? What's it look like?
Yeah, I think the plan was a week off, a week away, ideally, on a camp. And I think that's
right.
Traditionally, I think you remember Rangers and Celtic got their wrist slapped last year heavily by the First Minister. Obviously, one was a little bit more messy than the other, and don't need to go into any further detail on that.
Yeah.
And then a week's training we ended up having a bounce game. I think we played St Johnstone, if memory serves me right.
Right.
Just to get back into the swing of things.
Because, look, it is true, you know, Newcastle, it's colder than it is down south in London. It's, you know, 3 or 4 degrees warmer down there, and Scotland's probably another degree. And, you know, so the January, having a January break makes a hell of a lot of sense, because you may have a bit of snow anyway and if matches cancelled. So have you found it beneficial?
We've not won in the league since the break, so probably probably not. But that's not my remit, is it? That's probably more a question for Graeme.
Yeah,
I think fundamentally, yes. I think it's good to have a refresh, a reset. That's one thing, you know, for sure. I think my thoughts on it perhaps are, you know, actually you could have a three week break, and then it snows for 3 weeks, so you know you can't actually position that break exactly when the weather's going to hit, because you don't know when the weather's going to hit. So, yeah, I think the guys enjoy it, you know, from the boys that have worked up there for such a long period. It's part of the season. Added to the fact you've got four international breaks as well, you know, and a relaxed season, it just adds to that ability just to reset. And, you know, that never comes perfectly, does it? In our case, you know, the data will, or the stats will tell you that it's not worked for us, but in truth, we all know the reason. It's got nothing to do with that. You know, it's just that you're playing against somebody else and they've been better than you on the day, or you've not taken your chances.
Yeah.
Excellent. Nicky, you obviously mentioned some of the players that you'd bought in. What's your actual scouting and recruitment structure and network? Have you got full-time staff, part-time staff? Are they UK? Are you seeing these players from overseas initially through you know, data or something like that? How does it work at Motherwell?
Yeah, the structure we put in place was pretty much a blank canvas, and that was again COVID related, because, you know, previous head of recruitment had left. COVID had meant that we'd, like a lot of clubs, stripped back on scouts. There wasn't games to go to. So we have I won't put a number on it, because the number will be wrong, and then I'll tell you one more or one less. So our approach is quite simple. It's it's everything available. So we're not led by data, but we're supported by data, but heavily supported by that. And that was the case. That was the situation that I decided to take at AFC Wimbledon as well, and they've continued since. I think, you know, most clubs or a lot of clubs are doing that now. So we're supported by that. So for argument's sake, if it was a player from abroad that we didn't know that came through an agent who said, look, got this player, he's great, but we don't know anything about him, the common sense approach is just to check the data platform and see what he flags up like. If he flags up great, then we pass him on to a consultant company that we have that turn reports around pretty quickly. They're excellent, and they'll cover three games for us. It's then passed up the chain, or it stops at that point. That's for a player from abroad. Scout support, I'm really passionate about giving opportunities to young, hungry talent. We do that in sort of two ways, really. So we have a volunteer program that's partly linked to one of the universities. So one of my guys is an undergrad there with scouting experience. He's a mature student. I've got another guy who's looking to move from the agency world into recruitment. So we're giving him an opportunity to be able to, you know, take that next step. I've got another young boy who's really new into it. All these guys have gone through probably either the talent ID in England, Scotland, or through IPSO or the PFSA. We partner with IPSO, so they provided us with a first team scouting course, which our academy scouts were on, and also paying customers. So we hope.
That's interesting. That's interesting. How did that go, Nick? Was that good?
It was really good.
Involved in that, yeah.
So I spoke with Colin Chambers, and he was keen to get a partnership. It just worked for us, and it seemed like a really common sense approach. You know, if we're a fan owned club, as you know, so everything about us is about investing in people and investing in the people of Motherwell. Investing in our supporters, you know, and it's just an extension of that, really. So I don't know. It's what I believe passionately. And, you know, I've had lots of opportunities over the course of my career in various ways to be able to stay in it. And I've also seen, you know, a lot of people that have been in institutions for a long time that perhaps just get ingrained in it, and it becomes not exciting for them anymore. So they just becomes acceptable to be part of a football club. And I don't believe that. I believe that, you know, you've got to stay hungry. You've got to challenge yourself all the time, and you've got to look for the next best thing and stay ahead of the curve. So our way of doing that is just constantly analysing, constantly looking at what talent is out there, whether that's through social media or through people we know.
Interesting. And who do you see as your main competitors in the SPL for players? Is there the same teams that you brush up against? I want to push you on the Ross Tierney signing, because he was one of, if not the best player in the League of Ireland last year, Irish under 21. No disrespect to Motherwell or whatever, I thought that was a major capture, really. As freely as you can speak, you know, using that as the example, who are the top teams that you're battling with? English teams, I imagine, as well.
I think everybody. I think it's a difficult one to answer, Ryan, because I don't know. I mean, as you know, Tony, if I'm having a conversation with Tony, or somebody like Tony, he's probably not going to tell me who the other clubs are. He'll probably allude to it. He may do, but if he is doing, he's doing it for a reason. And then that's up to me to decide what that reason is. It's either a reason to put me off and say, don't even go there because he's not going to come to you. Or it's because he actually wants to just plant a seed where there's a really good opportunity. Yeah. But it all comes back for me to relationships and relationships with agents. and the player. And for us, like every club, you've got to have your own USP. So our USP is really simple. It's we'll provide you with a platform. You'll take that and you'll either, you know, thrive or you won't. We hope that you will if we've done our work right, and then we'll sell you, and we'll sell you pretty quickly because it is the football club's model and we don't hide away from that. So that's, I think that's good for us. And it's easy for me to say it, but just in terms of the competition naturally are those clubs around your budget. So yeah. I alluded to the clubs in England.
Yeah.
AFC Wimbledon will be one because our budgets are probably not too far apart. Accrington in League One, you know, those teams, Morecambe at the lower end of the league. And then you're probably ruling out maybe three or four of the higher profile League Two teams. We're certainly not competing with Wrexham and Chesterfield in the National League and Stockport, where I know you were. Because there's no salary cost management scheme in that league, so they can pay what they want. So it's madness. But in terms of the SPL, St Mirren, Livingston, Dundee, Ross County, and who have I missed from that? There's one other. Those are the clubs, St Johnstone. Those are the clubs that we'll be competing against financially.
We were just talking before, Nick, that SPL group, obviously, you know, Rangers and Celtic are right up at the top, but that group from about fourth to about 10th is such a tight group of clubs. It's incredible, isn't it? You know, it's like, obviously, if people on the call aren't aware, there's a split that comes at sixth place. So you're trying to it makes the league very competitive in that sort of mid division, doesn't it? Because everyone's trying to get into the top six. It's a bit like trying to get into Europe in the Premiership. You're trying to get in the top six ready for the split. So you're playing the bigger teams and you're obviously everything's better for the club. But that itself must bring some, you know, horrendous pressures.
Yeah, I think it does. Obviously, you know, there's a big advantage financially for finishing in that top six, especially the way it looks this season. So it is important, you know, and you're still liable and vulnerable if you finish in the bottom six, even if you've had a reasonably good season, dependent on what the bottom two look like. So if you were to, you know, fall into the, you know, that seventh place as the split happens, you know, and the difference between 12, 11 and 7 is really small, you know, you could end up on a bad roll and in the league below. So certainly that's where the pressure comes in.
There's a few questions from people tuning in that we'll just quick answers if you can before we move on. Can asks, Nick, according to your observation and experience, at what age do you think a foreign player's integration align with their performance better in generally in terms of their social and cultural aspects? So at what age are they able to come over and hit the ground running in terms of performance more easily?
I think it's country dependent. I think at the moment it's easier for us to bring in players from South America into Scotland, but you know, common sense tells you that culturally there are bigger differences, you know, compared to perhaps Scandinavia or northwestern Europe. So yeah, it's not as simple as that. I think it all comes down to, and you mentioned one player there, Ross Tierney, it all comes down to the character of the player, you know. It's been no trouble at all to get any of the four boys that we've brought from outside, you know, the UK, you know, because they've wanted to come. They've seen the opportunity. They've seen the pathway. They've seen the league. They're excited by it. And they're all different. As I said, Jahani's played in five countries. Sol's only ever played really at one club in Norway. Yet he's flourished and is really open to it. So, yeah, no right or wrong.
And then just to amalgamate a couple of the other questions as a final question, do you see the exemptions panel staying in Scotland? Is that what you're hearing, or is it an inevitability that at some point there's going to have to be a black and white situation?
I think it'll evolve. I think, as we see at the moment, it's in permanently. It's certainly not a case where it's only until the end of the season, then it'll be reviewed from what I can gather. So, yeah, I think it'll evolve. As like I said before, it'll all be down to the fact of, you know, if we end up with, you know, every 1 to 11 in across six games on a weekend are there's not a Scottish player in the team, then, you know, that'll be a big red flag. So I don't think we'll get there, but, you know, I think it's got to be monitored for sure.
Brilliant. For the time being, thank you very much, Nick. Tony, just to move it on before we introduce Graeme, you're going to speak a little bit about the next Football Transfer Forum Live.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, Ryan. Obviously the Football Transfer Forum, we did our last event at Leicester City Football Club in November. Both Nick, obviously Ryan as our fantastic host was there, but Nick and Graeme attended, which was great. I think we had Darren Mowbray as well from Aberdeen. So there was Scottish representation at the Transfer Forum. The next one, we're hoping to get back to normal, which is to do two Transfer Forums per year, one before the summer window and one before the winter window. So it'll be 2022. The next Transfer Forum is Wednesday, the 20th of April. It's at the Etihad Stadium in Manchester, obviously home of Manchester City. And we've gone, we've been there before. It was a fantastic event. The facilities are really, really top draw. I sort of likened it to going into a posh restaurant. Not that I go in that many posh restaurants, but it's really, really top facilities. We're looking to do it in the Tunnel Club this time, which is it's an interesting venue on two levels. It's probably the best venue in the stadium. And we're looking to have a big audience. You know, we had a good event at Leicester. So we're hoping for the same again. Ryan and I are actually talking to a couple of potential speakers. We're looking to have a top sporting director, at least one, and we're probably looking at an agent as well, a top agent. So there'll be something for everyone in that. I've already got lots of companies coming along. So if you are working in the football industry, involved in football transfers, scouting or recruitment, you know, there's something at the Football Transfer Forum for you. And for me, you know, it is a big networking event. We have some speed networking, which is always a bit of fun, but it is a good way to meet and contact people in the industry.
Tony, do you want to tease anything else out about any other Football Transfer Forum events coming up in the near future?
Yeah, well, I would guess we invited the guys from the Tournoi Maurice Revelot, which is a tournament in the south of France that I've been to a couple of times. They came along as my guests to our event, and they've got a fantastic tournament in the south of France, which happens between May, the last couple of days in May and early June. I think we're going to put a football transfer forum on in the south of France. I know Ryan was looking forward to a bit of sun and a bit of a holiday, but it's actually for work purposes. We're just talking, they're going to announce, I think the Tournoi Maurice Revelot, look out for it, because they're going to announce their tournament program on the 21st of March.
Tony, so, just for guys who don't know the tournament, can you just describe what tournament, and of course it's got an interesting aspect to it, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's known in the business, to be honest, as the Toulon tournament, although its name's changed over the years, but people who've been going back historically to the tournament refer to it as the Toulon tournament. It's actually the Tournoi Maurice Revelot, and it's for under-21s, under-20 players. And what you'll find is there's 12 teams of different nationalities, and national teams come over and compete. And you tend to find a lot of scouts and agents go there because, you know, there's just some super, super talent. The 2 years that I've been, the first time was, I think, 2015. My player, the player that I liked in the games that I went to see was Presnel Kimpembe, who's at PSG and a French international now. The last time, the player that I really liked was Anthony from a Brazilian player who ended up in that summer going from, I think it was it Corinthians or Sao Paulo, I get mixed up, whether Douglas Luiz was from which one, but he went to Ajax in the summer after the tournament. But the player of the tournament was Douglas Luiz, who ended up going straight from one of the Brazilian clubs to Aston Villa. So it's a really good ground for scouts. And obviously, you know, you've got to know your way around the GBE rules. And obviously these guys, it's a really good place to have a look at future talent. And, you know, I know there's teams from South America, there's teams from Asia, there's teams from Africa, there's teams that you wouldn't normally see. Plus, you've got, you know, you like your French team as well. That's very, very high quality. So it's a really good tournament. And you know, that's why we're trying to team up with the Tournoi Maurice Revelo guys to put another football transfer forum. It'll be the first one outside of the UK, basically. And it'll be in the south of France.
Yeah. And it's important to say, Tony, as well, the players that are participating in that tournament for their nations, for their countries, that it contributes to their GBE points.
Well, it's such a prestigious tournament that when the people that developed the GBE rules sat down, they put it in their rules and regs as a band one tournament. So when players are stepping on the pitch, they're actually gaining points. They're actually gaining points towards the GBE pass, if you like. So even players who come from countries that wouldn't normally qualify for GBE, if they step on the pitch at the Toulon tournament, automatically they've got some points in the bank. And I know the guys, you know, there's been a lot more interest from many, many countries just simply because of that fact.
Fantastic. So, Tony, how and when can people find out about both of these events?
Yeah, well, it's important to follow us on Football Transfer Forum on LinkedIn. We have a mailing list of all of our events, and we tend to use Eventbrite as a platform to inform people. And, you know, if you think that you could be, have a look on the Eventbrite page of Football Transfer Forum. But obviously contact me or Ryan or Guy through LinkedIn, and we'll send you some details out.
Very good. Excellent. Thank you for that. It's time to introduce our second guest of the webinar, first team scout at St Mirren, Graeme. Are you, Graeme, you okay? Just on mute, Graeme.
There we go. Morning.
There you go.
Just a final little technical glitch for me.
Listen, it's not the Football Transfer Forum unless there's some sort of horrendous technical situation. how are you, Graeme? I was following the score last night. It was 2-0 at Celtic, yeah?
Yeah. Seems to be that they've put up a good fight for the first half and it's kept it pretty tight. I think it was 55 minutes they conceded. And then you're kind of up against it at Parkhead then. And obviously a second's going in late in the game. I was actually at Dundee myself, so I was literally just following the scores coming in. Dundee Hibs, where I managed to catch Hibs for the second goal, the second game running in a goalless draw. So absolutely don't want to be seeing them again anytime soon.
Fantastic. Excellent. I mean, we touched on it with Nick. It's extremely congested in that sort of middle section of the SPL this year. I think for the purpose of the guys tuning in, first of all, just a little bit about your background and what you're doing at St Mirren, and then some observations on how this season's playing out.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I've been the chief scout at St Mirren since last summer, since going in full-time last summer, but I'd actually been working with the club for the last three seasons now. This season has seen me kind of taking on a lot extra tasks in addition to the next opponent work that I previously did as a part-time member of staff. But the recruitment side is something that I've now been looking at a lot more this season. In conjunction with the previous manager, obviously we've just gone through a change of manager in the last couple of weeks, so there's a little bit of discussion, a little bit of changes going on, a few adjustments being made just as everyone gets used to the new manager. So for the time being, I think as well, because they have spent some time in League One previously in England at Morecambe, I've jumped back onto the focus being on some next opponent work just at the moment, just so that we can you know, get up to speak.
Graeme, you know, Jim Goodwin's obviously been doing a good job to be poached by Aberdeen, you know, a bigger club with respect to St Mirren. So, you know, was that a bit of a shock, or, you know, how did you feel about it?
I don't think so. I think that's kind of the nature of the league. I think that the only shock is that Nick and I had a chat about this on Sunday. I'm sure he won't mind me saying, but, you know, Jim's been well quoted for a good couple of years as he's kind of risen through the ranks. But really, it depends on, everything seems to me, in my experience in the game, to be about timing. It really does, because when a job like that comes up, if you're going through, and everybody goes through it every season, they go through a tough spell where you're maybe struggling to get a win. Everyone else goes through, you know, spells where they've managed to go through 8, 9, 10 games unbeaten. So as well as doing really well at the club you're at, as well as being well thought of, as well as having all the tools you need to go and progress, you need that little bit of luck of timing.
Yeah, absolutely.
At the same time as a big job comes available. And this was Jim's, you know, this was Jim's time. It was absolutely inevitable. He'd spoken quite openly about it previously, in that, you know, he was a club legend at St Mirren. He'd captained them to the last time they won a trophy in 2013. So, you know, loved around the club. He loves the club. He's spoken about that, but he'd also been open about the fact that he did have ambitions to manage higher up, and this was his time. But it could easily have happened that, you know, it was Nick and Graeme Alexander that were going at the time. I think at the time as well, Jim was maybe the third longest serving manager in the league, having been at St Mirren for like 3 years. So again, it shows you the kind of 18-month shelf.
It's not just managers, is it? You know, the SPL, with having Celtic and Rangers in there, there's always the opportunity for one of your players, you know, to be picked off by arguably bigger clubs in the league, isn't there? And I suppose, you know, Nick mentioned their sort of player trading model. That's got to be seen as a good thing. It's got to be seen as a positive thing, hasn't it?
Absolutely. I mean, if you look at somebody like Hibs at the moment, Hibs have got Paul McGinn, Jake Doyle-Hayes, Kyle McGuinness. These are three players that played for us over the last sort of two seasons. Yeah. They've even got a kit man.
He must have been a good kit man, was he?
he was the most expensive deal.
Yeah, I'm making light of that, but, you know, I mean, Jack Ross was there as well, who was an excellent Mirren manager. So, you know, he'd worked with the kit man before, and that was seen as a step up. Potentially not always necessarily, you know, in football terms, but certainly in the sort of wages and things like that a club like Hibs can offer, with, you know, the facilities, a big stadium that they've got, and number of season ticket holders and everything else. So, and as well, you know, Jamie McGrath's just gone down to Wigan. There's a couple of ex-St Mirren players that have come through our academy in the Premiership and Championship, or Premier League and Championship in England. So, of course, it always has to be really a kind of a stepping stone to bigger, I wouldn't say better things, but certainly bigger things.
I think
the rounding they're getting at clubs like ours is fantastic, because you're getting to play at places like Celtic and Rangers, and you're getting a real experience of getting minutes in the team and being able to establish yourself, getting appearances under your belt. So I think it's a real rounded experience that some of the boys get before they go and take a step into, you know, maybe a more glamorous club or a higher division.
Mm.
No, really interesting. So what one of the things that, you know, just moving on from that, so in terms of the practicalities of where you choose to scout for the first team, you know that in terms of budget, you're not going to be able to compete, even with that middle section down from Celtic and Rangers. So, you know, what practical steps do you take in terms of whereabouts you go to watch games, or is that not a consideration?
No, I mean, of course it's a consideration, you know, in so many ways, just as you've mentioned, in terms of the budget and in terms of actually organising myself as a scout to get out and see them, in terms of the networks that you're relying on. So, I mean, it's very much a kind of a strategically led exercise, in that you're looking at it in conjunction with the manager at the start of the season. You're, you know, you're having a discussion around budgets and styles and things like that, and the type of player you want to attract. So all of these things have to be taken in, into consideration before you just sort of jump in the car and you know, point it south and head to a game. I did do an element of that at the first half of the season, just because I was familiarising myself with English football, and I was quite happy to take in games basically anywhere, just so that I could have a look at and make, you know, gauge what I was actually looking at. But most of the time you want to be very, very focused on where you're going.
Sure. And you know, we spoke to Nick about the sort of loan system as well. And it's a question that we've asked quite a lot on the Football Transfer Forum over there. Is there any value in terms of real value to your first team in taking an under 23 player out of a Cat 1, Cat 2 academy here? The question is really, is the academy system in England producing relevant players for your first team? You know, is that development pathway, the development games, a good enough comparison to what your first team guys? My personal perspective is that it's not. Tony and I were at the Newcastle Middlesbrough 23s games a couple of weeks ago. I was really disappointed. Nothing happened in the game. So is that section of players, those academy players out of Cat 1, Cat 2, is that, are they still of interest to you as loans?
It depends. It really just depends on the player. There can be sort of exceptions. I wouldn't like to turn around and sort of tar the whole entire under 23 system with the same brush. We would prefer to not be looking at first loans. I would rather that somebody had been out and had some experience, even, you know, if it's League Two, if it's National League, whatever it happens to have been. There's a few have found their way up here to the Championship in Scotland. So these are the kinds of things that I would look at. You can find that people go out for a first loan and come back and spend another 6 months with the under-23s with their club. They can also be training alongside the first team while they're still playing for the under-23s, so that's a consideration. One of my observations when I started watching the 23s this season was that there were almost sort of two or three levels within even a starting 11. You know, you could identify boys that were coming in as 18-year-olds that are just stepping up from the under-18s. Then you've got ones that are sort of becoming established, and then you've got those other ones that I spoke about that have already been out on loan are coming back. Yeah. So there's quite a diverse range of abilities even in a starting 11 in the 23s.
Ryan, you know, Nick took a players from Celtic as well. Are you looking at the Celtic and Rangers? And obviously they've got B teams now, haven't they? I meant to mention that, because that was an interesting situation where Celtic and Rangers have got the B teams in the Lowland League. So Is that another, alongside the English just 23s? Are you looking Celtic Rangers, maybe Hibs and Hearts? I don't know.
Yeah, it can be. I mean, Hibs and Hearts, in terms of the young ones at Hibs and Hearts, generally, if they're good enough, they'll be in the team at sort of 17, 18. You've got examples of that. You know, Josh Doig and Hearts, you've got Aaron Hickey is now in Italy. They've traditionally have put boys into the first team really, really young. You know, Harry Cockram's another one's not there now, but I think he was like 16. He was playing fairly regularly. They do send some boys out on loan, Hibs and Hearts, but Hibs especially, you would tend to find that it's maybe the Championship sort of level or yeah. League One that those boys would go to. Rangers and Celtic can be a different story. I watched Ewan Henderson playing for Hibs last night, who's on loan from Celtic, and you've got people like Glenn Middleton, who's been out from Rangers. He's a couple of loans at St Johnston. So, you know, there are possibilities. I heard Nick talking or being asked about the kind of competition there. These boys, there obviously is quite a lot of competition for them. They'll get brought into the picture as well. I think different managers have preferences as well. There's certain teams that will be, you know, six, seven, eight loan players in their squad. Other managers don't maybe like that so much. They'll keep it down to two or three. So it depends on your manager and the preference of the manager you're working with also.
Yeah, Nick, just to bring you back in here, are you getting out to a lot of under 23 games here in England? And what's your perception of the level? And the other consideration is, post-January, like Newcastle, for example, they've shipped out all their decent players out on loan. And now you're starting to see some ridiculous results in the 23s, you know, big scores, 6-7 nils. You know, what are your thoughts on all that?
Yeah, no, I do. I probably split my actual live scouting between the 23s league, League Two, League One, National League, down here. So, yeah, I think it's. I was sort of circling right back. I mean, I going back to 10 years ago, I was involved at QPR in the academy right at the start of ECPP. So fundamentally, I think it's been the best thing that English football has done. But from 10 years ago to now, there is still an issue with on the under 23 league. Everything below, it's been fantastic. But they've not quite got that right. The start of the season, they were really young, I thought. I actually went to a fantastic game, Leeds and Spurs, who were quite well matched in terms of ages. Boy that went to Blackburn, Dylan Markande scored a hat trick in about 20 minutes that day. With a load of scouts there, and then I left at around about 60 minutes, a bit like I did when I saw Graeme at Hibs on Sunday to get to our game at Ibrox. I shot across to Merseyside, to Southport, to Liverpool, Everton, which usually is ultra competitive. And I think there was Shea Ojo playing for Liverpool and everybody else was under 18, literally. Everton had a host of 17. So it is hit and miss. I was always involved in coaching, always thinking, like Graeme said, about second loans, because you get those sort of, you roughen them edges a little bit, you know, you get the transition of having to live away from home, et cetera, et cetera. All the comforts are not there. But then at Wimbledon, we did really well with first loans. So the two, well, actually the three better ones were Marcus Force, that we took, it was first loan from Brentford, and then two boys from Brighton, Ryan Longman, who's now signed for Hull and doing really well, and Max Sanders, who's not quite done it at Lincoln. And they were great first loans. So that's your sort of due diligence bit, I suppose, where it's me and Graeme have got to sort of decide, you know, whether they're ready. So yeah, I think it's a really good market, but it's like Graeme's experience, you know, you can go to one game and you'll go and you'll think there's no chance any of these boys are going to play for us. But then another day you'll see somebody and you'll go, actually, you know what? Yeah, I can see enough in him to put him to the manager.
And Graeme, you know, certainly, you know, here in England now, the depth of the pyramid is fantastic. It's a real, Tony and I always talk about it, it's sort of crowning jewel of our game, really. And you've got teams in, you know, the division below, National League North and South, that are full time. I mean, how, in terms of the pyramid, where do you look down to? You know, here in England, will you be at National League North games?
I haven't been. No, I've been to the National League, the Premier League games, just a couple of times. But again, that kind of comes down to sort of resource at the club. It literally was myself and the manager, and you know, you can only really be in one place at the one time. So, you know, like Nick, you've done that kind of ducking and diving, and you're running away from one game at 60 minutes, 75 minutes to go, and you know, nip over 50 miles to another game or something like that. To you know, two and three games in a day can be quite common, but still I have to really prioritise what I'm looking at. So as much as I would love to go and find these sort of hidden gems at that type of level, I tend to have to do more sort of video work on those sorts of levels, and only then would I sort of say, yeah, there's something that's worth kind of going and looking at. But to get there, he's going to have to get past sort of 2, 3, 4, 5 players that are already on my list.
Sure.
So,
and Graeme, you know, in Scotland, and we met up at Stirling University and at Alloa as well. Talk to us about the pyramid in Scotland and how and where you're looking in, further down. I mean, I was saying to Nick at the start, you know, Arbroath being top of the Championship at the moment is quite a shock, you know, isn't it? It's not a normal, but, you know, talk to us about the lower leagues in Scotland.
Yeah, I mean, it's a shock on paper, I would say, and maybe to people from the outside looking in. But, you know, Arbroath, I've got a wily old manager, and he's been around the block. He's done it at several clubs, Dick Campbell. And the other thing that they do have is, albeit they're part-time, what they've managed to do is scoop up the best sort of part-time players in that particular division. And just because they're part-time doesn't necessarily make them any worse than some of the full-time boys. There's a certain level in Scottish football where the transition happens from full to part-time, where there are boys who are more than capable of playing at a much higher level full-time, but it so happens that they've got other interests outside of the game. They've got other well-paying jobs and things like that. Mm-hmm. And they just decide on a personal basis to combine the two that way. So, you know, just because Arbroath are sort of seen as the part-timers in the league, it did take them a season or two to get established. We were in the Championship with Alloa before they came up. So we sort of had the mantle of the best part-time team club in Scotland for that season. Then they came up and joined us the following season and after we had left. But as you go down, it's quite a mixture. League One, you're finding a lot of the Premiership loan players are rocking up in there just now. League Two as well. With the pyramid, you've got teams now like Cove Rangers have come up from the Highland League, Kelty Hearts have come up from the Lowland League. Yeah. So it's only been in the last two or three years that gateway has been open to them from the Highland and Lowland Leagues. The champions of each of those play off at the end of the season. The winner then goes and plays the bottom team in League Two. And that's for their place in the league. So then at the Lowland League, you're getting teams now throwing a lot of money at trying to get up into this pyramid. So again, you've got players with sort of Premiership, Championship experience playing now in the fifth tier in Scotland, just because that's where the money is. They're getting more money there than they would sometimes at the lower end of the Championship, higher end of League One. So individual players, you can find good players at really any level.
I noticed there were sort of the clubs that you mentioned that have come through, Kelty Hearts and Cove Rangers, do well or almost automatically in the next league up, don't they? They're doing really well, and you know, it'll be interesting to see how far they can go.
I think both of those clubs will definitely have ambitions at some. Mm. At some time making an assault on the Premiership, definitely. I don't think there's any two ways about it. Cove Rangers especially are sort of sitting there in the shadow of Aberdeen, which, you know, it has been a one city club, but they are working quite closely, I think, with Aberdeen, have their links and things like that, and will be really looking as they come up to try and probably poach away some of the Aberdeen fans when it's occasions where Aberdeen are maybe playing away and things like that. I was at the opening of their new stadium, must be maybe 3 years ago now, and they've got a really tidy setup up there. They're putting lots of resource into it. You know, they're attracting a real high caliber of manager and likes of Paul Hartley, and they've got a load of players, as I say, that have experience, you know, much higher up. So yeah, they're a serious proposition. We played Kelty Hearts in the cup just a few weeks ago and managed to get a very positive result. But that was, I think, because of the fact that we were under no illusions we were about to face. And it was a real professional performance from the boys. And the fact that they got to that stage of the cup, they'd already actually put out St Johnstone in the previous round. So, you know, on their day, if you don't sort of manage to have a performance, then you're going to find yourself being the next scalp.
We asked Nick this a little bit earlier on. What do you see as the issues in Scottish football? Do you see any sort of structural issues that, if you were in charge, Graeme, you would change for the benefit of the clubs and players?
Yeah, but I mean, there's one obvious one at the moment for me, and it's been since COVID. There's absolutely no reserve football whatsoever, and it baffles me. It really does. I was used to watch quite a lot of the reserve football. And while it's beneficial perhaps to some of the ones that are further up the academies because they're now forced out into loans, into League One, League Two, in the Championship, and they're getting that first team experience. Mm-hmm. There's a whole level of boys that are not quite ready for that, that are, if they're not still young enough for the under-18s, what are they doing? You know, it's they're in danger of just being completely lost. So I really don't know what's going on there. And I would like to sort of see that back sooner rather than later.
I think, can I just add on to that? I think that's an interesting one. It relates to that 23s problem. And I think that's the issue down in England, is that there's never been... some clubs will decide that the best place for their players to develop is within their club environment, within the way that they play. And I know if you talk about the best players at the best clubs, they're always going to be in that situation, the ones that are going to get early opportunities. And then you get those at the other end of the spectrum that might not have to. I think where the advantage is in the pyramid down in England is the size, and you alluded to it, it's the size of the pyramid. So, and again, I'll refer back to my last club because they disbanded the 23s because they were winning the 23s league at Cat 3 level every year, but not producing players for the first team. And it's also, interestingly, a sort of similar sort of philosophy that they've tried to rectify at QPR, who went, I think, 16 years without a player coming through, is that sometimes the argument is that you know, that senior experience, that learning what to win and lose in a competitive environment, ultimately is better for more than it is for the general population of players. But Graeme makes a really good point that if you don't have that pathway into senior football in the country or the league that you're in, and it's tougher, obviously, I know, in terms of the levels in Scotland and the pyramid, that's the challenge. I think there's a bit of a chat, conversations going on at the moment about bringing it back for next season. Graeme, I don't know.
I'm just wondering whether, you know, that this is the first time Rangers B and Celtic B have been playing in the Lowland League. And let's, you know, has it worked? Has that, you know, it'd be interesting to find out how those two clubs have approached it, because you potentially could see that being extended for more clubs who maybe want to do that. Is that a potential idea, Graeme? What do you think?
I'm going to back that one away slightly because...
All right, okay.
It's a bit of a political issue that, I mean, there's been, Rangers and Celtic have been after B teams, Colt teams within the actual league pyramid for quite some time now.
All right.
So getting them into the Lowland League is very much a step, I think, towards that. So the decisions on that one will be for people quite above my level within the SPFL.
Graeme, people talked about it in England as well, didn't they? And people, the general consensus was, well, we don't really like that idea because, you know, we've got unique football clubs playing in, you know, and we, you know, it happens in Spain all the time. They've got some very, you know, their development pathway is fantastic because they've got some very strong B teams playing in very strong leagues as well. And, you know, you look at a club like Brentford with their B team that's not actually in a league, but it's there and it's playing, you know, that probably fits quite nicely for some clubs.
Holland as well, I think, is a very good example. And, you know, they're playing in the second tier up against good second tier teams. And I think it is a very valid consideration in that. I've had an argument or a debate with other scouts as to whether it's ideal for a reserve team that's full of young boys to be playing against a senior team.
Yeah.
Other managers would tell you that it's not so much that, but they actually have to be playing alongside senior players, people that will kind of talk them through a game, people that they can really sort of learn from. So, you know, there are lots and lots of arguments for it. Everybody's going to find that they're different way and they're going to make the best of the opportunities that they're given. So again, from my own personal point of view, I'm basically looking at, you know, the due diligence, as Nick said, and what does this particular boy, what sort of skills has he picked up from the pathway he's gone, rather than trying to, you know, be too involved in the kind of overview. I tend to just take it as I find it, and these conversations will go on, and I'll have the football that I've got to watch at whatever levels it is, and I'll try and place it into context and make a decision from there.
Yeah, I think that the Johnson's Paint Trophy here in England, and Nicky would have been involved in that at AFC Wimbledon. I think that's been a great window into how far away these 23s programs are from the first team. You know, you'll see Wolves get battered off, you know, Port Vale or whatever. And Nick, I'm sure you've come up against some of the good first team, you know, Premier League 23s in that competition. I mean, what do you think, Nick, on you know, B teams in Scotland, B teams in England?
We did, just loons out, we played against a £34 million worth of Leicester team one year at Scunthorpe, which was quite interesting.
Yeah.
Apparently it was forced on the 23s manager at the time to play those players, obviously. What do I think? I don't believe in the UK that model is right for the UK, and it all reverts back to the strength down here of the 92, and in Scotland, the number of the clubs up there, it's different. I'm not saying we're unique, but I think it's part of our culture that it's about, you know, supporting every single club within that pyramid, and then the ones below. I think it's all down to individual preference. It's about, if you're an academy manager, you have to know the right pathway for your players. You're employed to do that. So if the right pathway for that player is to accelerate him into your first team, accelerate him into somebody else's first team, or to keep him with you in your academy to develop until that next point in time is right, I think that's the right way. And then we all have to, you know, pitch for, you know, the best talent for our own clubs at that right time. So yeah, not for me, not the B team, no.
Brilliant. Let's just get through some of the questions that people have sent across. There's one here for you, Nick, and that's whether the club would ever think about any African players. Is that, we've obviously just had the African Cup of Nations as well. Has it ever been on your radar, either players currently playing in Africa or African players playing in Europe?
I think it's easy. It comes down to the best player, you know, the best player. And I did, as a few people know that follow me on LinkedIn, I did a breakfast event for the football club last week, and I got asked a question about our academy boys. So obviously we've had a number of boys that have come through our academy that we've sold on. And I answered it in the same way, you know, it'll be the best player. So if the best players within our academy for that part of our succession plan. So if it's, you know, if we won't, you know, if we've got a talented left winger in the building, we won't be going anywhere else to look for a similar age left winger, because we'd be blocking the pathway of that player. And then it doesn't fit in with our model. So no, yes, the answer is yes. I've had a couple of agents recently pitching a few players. Interestingly, we've got Bevis Mugabe, who's a Ugandan international. So automatically we're going to bring, you know, a load of boys from Uganda, because Bevis will want to play with his mates. That sort of thing happens. Dundee United, I know, you know, brought a boy in from either Uganda or Ghana, an 18-year-old that's in their academy. So yeah, it'll happen for sure.
Yeah, and what about yourselves, Graeme? I mean, you know, people do see the sort of GBE as restricted in some ways, but of course now it opens up work permits pretty much for anybody around the world if they can obviously get the points. Is that something on St Mirren's radar?
I wouldn't like to speak for the new manager. We've not really got into these sorts of depth of conversations just yet. But, you know, if I'm looking sort of back, then again, I would just sort of echo what Nick said in terms of it will be if the player is suitable. From my own point of view, they do tend to be, and again, this is because of resources. You know, you're relying on a network. You're getting a lot of these are agent recommendations. And, you know, I'll take a look at them, and absolutely that's all good, and there seems to be a lot of talented players out there. But, you know, I'm looking at then people that I've seen, that I've managed to actually get to games and see. And it's difficult for me to put somebody that I've only seen on sort of video clips up above, you know, people that I've already seen 2, 3, 4, 5 times in the flesh. But no, look, you never say never. If I had all the resources in the world available to us and we were able to have a network of scouts, then of course, you're not going to be turning your nose up at any players from anywhere in the world. Again, talking about different players in the league, Jando Fuchs was at Dundee United before he's got his move. He was a Cameroon international. So, you know, of course, they're not as common, the African internationals, as some other nations. But I think over the years, you know, there have been plenty that have had experience of Scottish football, and it can only be a good thing.
Graeme, your cat just made an appearance there.
Oh, really? Oh, that's nice.
Who is it? Introduce us. Let's have a look.
Oh, that... We've got like a 10-week-old kitten that's just arrived in the building also, so she's tending to keep a low profile and keep out of his way.
Okay. Who is it? What's the cat called?
What's that?
What's the cat called?
The kitten?
No, this one.
This one's called Macy. This is Macy.
Is it your cat, is it?
Yes, my partner's cat.
It's not the neighbours, is it?
I don't know. It's actually outside of the window. I don't even know who it is.
One final question before we let you guys go and we wrap it up. Has COVID put to bed the notion of Rangers and Celtic moving into England at some point? From what you guys feel here, has that conversation died out now? Nick,
I never anticipated it happening anyway. That's obviously, you know, an Englishman playing, you know, working primarily in England. I just didn't see it, you know. But on two sides of the coin, really, you know, obviously more so now working in Scotland, you know, I don't see it being a benefit for the Scottish pyramid, you know, and I didn't see it at the time being, you know, the right thing for England. You know, it's an English league. And I know that people will say, well, you've got Welsh teams in there, but that's going back to when football started, really, primarily. So, yeah, no, not something that I envisage happening.
Yeah, and Graeme, whether you think it'll happen or not, what do you think? There are people in those two clubs that still want it to happen?
I'd imagine there probably are. I mean, it's been something that's come up on a regular basis for the last, what, 2 decades or something like that, maybe even more. But at the moment, we're more in danger of losing them to Australia anyway. They've just announced they're going to play a friendly in Sydney in November, first Old Firm game, or Glasgow Derby, depending on...
What, an actual league game, Graham? An actual league game?
No. I think it's the Sydney Cup, it's called. It's during the World Cup.
It'll be a
friendly game.
I thought it was going to be one of these 39th games that the Premier League were talking about where you play.
That idea was actually floated. There was a match between Dundee, I think it was, and Hibs a couple of seasons back, and they spoke about playing it in the United States. And I think both clubs had the sort of buy-in, but it just never quite got over the line. But that still sort of floats around on the periphery as well. But, you know, again, that's for club administrators and...
Absolutely. What I would actually like to see, and I don't know whether it's got any legs or there's any traction, but I'd like to see a UK FA Cup. So everyone, Northern Ireland, Wales, Scotland, England...
It used to exist, didn't it?
Play in the FA Cup and the start in the early rounds locally, you know, where closest to home, and then as they progress... Because it would be nice to have Scottish clubs playing English clubs, just that variety. Because sometimes I think in Scotland, you're playing each other too regularly. The size of the league, and I know we're at the end of the webinar and I'm bringing up a big point, but the size of the league sometimes, you know each other that well because you're playing now each other quite regularly. What do you think?
Yeah, I think in the Challenge Cup in Scotland, I think we have people who... are trying things, you know. I think they're definitely open. You know, we had Welsh sides, English sides, and Irish sides invited into the Challenge Cup last season, but there's a logistical problem there as well because of the level that was happening. It's smaller clubs, and I think each of the clubs were being given a sum of money, you know, if they were drawn away in these competitions to help with obviously the expenses that they were incurring, because it's
you know, far beyond a Scottish League One side, for example, that all of a sudden finds himself playing in the south of England. They're not used to that level of expense with hotels and the travel and everything else. So, I think it's good that we've got people at the sort of top of the game that are open to these ideas and that are exploring all the avenues. But sort of my worry with this kind of a UK-wide FA Cup would be that it would end up with the bigger the clubs you get, you know, that you'd end up with playing kids again as usual. My experience of the Papa John's Trophy as it is now this season was that I was going down to maybe try and watch one or two players, and then not saying I didn't see any players from it, but most of them didn't play. You know, even clubs down in sort of League One level and stuff like that were playing basically second 11s in them. Yeah. And you're playing. I saw Everton play their under 21s, it is, in that competition we're playing, and they'd 5 17-year-olds on the pitch, I think it was.
Yeah. I probably think, Graeme, we probably need a couple of seasons of just stability and just like getting back to.
I think the whole world needs that, to be quite honest.
I'm just talking about Scottish football, but and English football, just two regular seasons where everything happens and it matches are played and on time, and yeah, that would be great, wouldn't it? We could just wish for that.
Fantastic. Guys, just before we finish off, I'm just going to share in the chat a link to a YouTube video, which is the promo for the FTF Expert Series that Tony and I have done with Steve Walsh. Have a look at that. We're just in the sort of Martin Scorsese final editing stage, aren't we, Tony? Of getting everything done on that, yeah. But it's going to be a really quality bit of insight. Yeah.
We sat down with Steve, didn't we? Steve Walsh. He's over in America with Charlotte as their special advisor, but obviously a very well known sporting director. And we sat down with Steve, and Ryan interviewed him over a couple of days, really, just to mine Steve for his knowledge and advice and guidance on the sporting director role and everything that he's been involved with. And it was I really enjoyed it, and I learned a lot just listening to you asking him the questions and Steve telling us, you know, from 30 years of experience. So, yeah, we're going to put that out shortly, and that will be a good watch.
Great stuff. Thank you. Thank you, Graeme. Thank you, Nick. Really appreciate your time. Good luck for the rest of the season. I know you're in there against each other. It's all very, very tight. So we'll definitely look out for the results, but really appreciate your time this morning.
You're welcome.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you very much.
Tony, thanks for your time as ever. And we'll be back again this time next month.
Yeah, the first Thursday of, where are we now? March? Is it March already? Bloody
March
hell.
March already, yeah.
Wow. First Thursday of April. All right, guys. See you. Thanks, Nick.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks for everyone tuning in.
Bye now.